Well, good morning. I want to welcome you to worship on the second Sunday of Lent, and a warm greeting to those of you who are visiting with us today, and a reminder to please fill this out so we know that you were here and communed with us this morning. A couple of announcements to share with you, two prayer requests, especially as we continue to pray for the Beck family on the death of John's oldest son, Zach. That funeral was here yesterday, so please keep the Becks in your prayers. Also, it's with a heavy heart that I also announced the death of Bill Winstrom. And Bill is a longtime member of Morningstar. Our prayers go out to Sydney on this occasion as well. That funeral will be here Friday at 11, followed by a luncheon immediately following. So please keep Sydney in your prayers. Well, the cat's out of the bag about coronavirus. You're seeing a lot of it on the news, and everybody's talking about it. And one concern that we have as we gather together as a community is to prevent that from spreading as much as we can, even though we really don't have much control over it anyhow. During the passing of the peace, at least for the temporary time being, one of the ways in which we can still pass the peace and not have to shake hands is to just simply place your hand over your heart and then look your neighbor in the eyes and say, "Peace of the Lord be with you." we can do fist bumps and elbow bumps if you would like, but this might be the best way to do that. And just for your information, when we do communion distribution, our pastors and our altar guild members, our sacristans, really take seriously now, we always have, washing our hands and making sure that our hands are clean. So we're going to do our best, and if you don't feel like you're comfortable shaking hands, you have permission not to and not to feel bad about it. So it is what it is, and we continue to keep our country and the world in our prayers as this virus kind of plays out a little bit. So just wanted to share that with you this morning. Those are all of our announcements, and again, welcome to worship. As we prepare our hearts and minds for worship, I invite you to stand as you're able with our confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God who is present, who gives life, who calls into existence the things that do not exist. Amen. If you were to keep watch over sins, O Lord, who could stand? Yet with you is forgiveness, and so we confess our sins together. Most gracious God, have mercy on us. We confess that we have turned away from you, knowingly and unknowingly. We have wandered from your resurrection life. We have strayed from your love for all people. Turn us back to you, O God. Give us new hearts and right spirits, that we may find what is pleasing to you and dwell in your house forever. Amen. Receive this good news, that God turns to you in love and says, "I will put my spirit in you, and you shall live." All of your sins are forgiven in the name of Jesus Christ, who is the free and abounding gift of God's grace for you. Amen. Amen. We continue with our opening song.
And at this time, I'd like to invite the small children to come up and play. We have a little playground here under the piano, and you can have some shakers today, kind of getting that idea of the journey in the desert. Their sand sounds.
As you are to worship.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy.
For the reign of God and for peace throughout the world, for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy.
For the strength to live your word, let us pray to the Lord.
Have mercy, Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, and defend us, O God.
O God, our leader and guide, in the waters of baptism, you bring us to new birth, to live as your children. Strengthen our faith in your promises, that by your Spirit we may lift up your life to all the world through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Be seated, please. Our first reading is from Genesis 12. The Lord said to Abram, "Go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land that I will show you. I will make of you a great nation, and I will bless you, and make your name great so that you will be a blessing. I bless those who bless you, and the one who curses you I will curse, and in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed." So Abram went, as the Lord had told him, and Lot went with him. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Up my eyes to the hills, my help comes from the Lord.
I lift up my eyes to the hills, my help comes from the Lord.
I lift up my eyes to the hills, from where is my help to come? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. The Lord will not let your foot be moved, nor will the one who watches over you fall asleep. Behold, the keeper of Israel will neither slumber nor sleep.
I lift up my eyes to the hills. My help comes from the Lord.
The Lord watches over you. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun will not strike you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will preserve you from all evil and will keep your life. The Lord will watch over your going out and your coming in from this time forth forevermore.
I lift up my eyes to the hills.
My help comes from the Lord.
Our second reading is from Paul's letter to the Romans, the fourth chapter. What then are we to say was gained by Abraham, our ancestor, according to the flesh? For if Abraham was justified by works, he has something to boast about, but not before God. For what does the Scripture say? Abraham believed God, and it was reckoned to him as righteousness. Now to one who works, wages are not reckoned as a gift, but as something due. But to one who without works trusts him who justifies the ungodly, such faith is reckoned as righteousness. For the promise that he would inherit the world did not come to Abraham or to his descendants through the law, but through the righteousness of faith. If it is the adherents of the law who are to be the heirs, faith is null and the promise is void. For the law brings wrath. But where there is no law, neither is there violation. For this reason, it depends on faith, in order that the promise may rest on grace and be guaranteed to all his descendants, not only to the adherents of the law, but also to those who share the faith of Abraham. For he is the father of all of us, as it is written, I have made you the father of many nations. In the presence of the God in whom he believed, who gives life to the dead and calls into existence the things that do not exist. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand.
Chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Now there was a Pharisee named Nicodemus, a leader of the Jews. He came to Jesus by night and said to him, Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do apart from the presence of God. Jesus answered him, Very truly, I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God without being born from above. Nicodemus said to him, How can anyone be born after growing old? Can one enter a second time into the mother's womb and be born? And Jesus answered, Very truly, I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of water and spirit. What is born of the flesh is flesh. What is born of the spirit is spirit. Do not be astonished that I said to you, you must be born from above. The wind blows where it chooses, and you hear the sound of it. But you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit. And Nicodemus said to him, How can these things be? And Jesus answered him, Are you a teacher of Israel, and yet you do not understand these things? Very truly, I tell you, we speak of what we know and testify to what we have seen, yet you do not receive our testimony. If I have told you about earthly things and you do not believe, how can you believe if I tell you about heavenly things? No one has ascended into heaven except the one who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. And just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Daily walking close to thee.
invite the congregation to be seated, and I'd like to invite our children forward for our children's message. Hey, guys. Good to see you. It is a snowflake. It's a magic snowflake. You know what makes it magic? What? It turns on when it sees, when it senses the darkness. Put your hand over that. See how that turns on? Oh. There we go. You got to put your hand right over it. Real good. All right. And it shines. When it senses darkness, that goes on. The light shines. And that's kind of an amazing thing, don't you think? I've had this in my planter in the front of my house. It's time to take it down because guess what? We don't want any more snow. So there's a story that I want to read to you about darkness and light, about a man who comes to Jesus at nighttime, and Jesus is that light that turns on when he senses darkness. In the middle of the night, a man named Nicodemus came to see Jesus. It was a strange time to visit someone, but Nicodemus had many questions about God, and he didn't want to wait. There was a lot of talk about Jesus. Many people didn't believe Jesus, and Nicodemus wasn't sure what he thought about it at all. He also wasn't sure he wanted anyone to see him. He knew that Jesus was talking about God in a whole new way, and some people didn't like it. That night, Jesus and Nicodemus talked for quite a while. They argued and wondered together about many things. And then Jesus said, "Really, all you need to know is this. God loves you. In fact, God loves everyone. And it's important that you know this and tell everyone you meet. God wants everyone to know how much they are loved." So Nicodemus, "God loves the world and everyone in it so much that God sent me his son so that everyone would learn how much they are loved. And God sent me to save the world, Nicodemus. I am the light of the world. I am all that is good and right, and God sent me to light up this world. Unfortunately, people sometimes like darkness better than light. When we do terrible things, the light is not in us. When we are mean, hateful, and horrible, the world is a dark, dark place. But when we do things that are good and right, when we love each other and help one another, God's light shines brightly in the world, and God is glad." And so I wanted to share that with you because I think that's kind of a neat way to share with you the story of Nicodemus and to know that this thing needs to be what? What does this need in order to shine the light? It needs to be charged, right? With the sun first, so that when it senses the light, that light shines. And just like this needs to be charged with light, guess who else needs to be charged with light? Yeah. We do. We are charged with God's light in our baptism. And we get to share that light with the world. And when the darkness comes, guess what? That light shines. And you, Drake and Gregory and Samuel, get to share that light with your families, with your friends, with everyone here, and with the world. Let us pray. Gracious God, we give you thanks for your light, that in times of darkness we remember that you are shining upon us. Help us to be charged full of your love, full of your forgiveness, full of the message that we belong to you, so that we too might share that light with this world. And bless these children here today as they share that light as well. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thanks for coming up today.
Grace and peace to you from our Lord and our Savior, Jesus the Christ. One of One of my favorite prayers is a prayer that comes from the funeral service. It's one of the intercessory prayers that we pray during a funeral service and did yesterday. It's a prayer that talks about just the how we can be so confused at the time of death and how we have so many questions and we turn to God, to one another, to seek answers for those questions. And especially when we have a funeral like we did yesterday of a 27-year-old man who was, you know, had all of life spread out before him. He had taken his bar exam. He was looking forward to entering into marriage with a partner that had been a partner with him for 5 years. He had great family support, and as we saw yesterday, he had a fantastic support of friends. You know, people, at least half of this congregation, maybe more like two-thirds, were all persons under the age of 30. It's not often you see a sanctuary, any sanctuary, that's filled with that many young people, young men and women. And there were a lot of questions. How could this happen? How did it happen? Questions about where is God in all of this? How can we find God in the midst of all of this? What is it about this that is so, it just grabs us and holds us and wonders, how do we understand this? And where do we find God in this? And I thought of those questions, and I thought of that prayer as I had studied and prepared for today. I just thought of Nicodemus, of how he had heard Jesus teaching, and he had seen Jesus perform many miracles, many signs, as he calls them, that God was present, that God was somehow present in this Jesus, in the person of Jesus. But he wanted to know how that could be. How is it that Jesus really brought forth this presence of God for the people whom he touched, the people who listened to him, the people he cared for and loved? And so he comes to Jesus in the dark of night because he's a leader of the Jews. He's a leader of the Sanhedrin, which is the council of the temple. They controlled the temple and much of the religious life and really controlled the religious life of Jerusalem. And so he couldn't be seen by those people as going to Jesus because Jesus had just thrown the money changers out of the temple. The previous chapter 2, talks about Jesus, you know, throwing all the money changers, throwing the people out of the temple who relied on that income for their livelihood, for their lives. And Jesus threw them all out. And now Nicodemus said, you know, it was thinking, you know, I can't be seen going to this guy, but he has raised all kinds of questions for me that I don't have answers for. And I have to see him. I have to talk to him. See what this is all about. And so that's where this story begins, is Nicodemus coming with his questions, with his many questions, in the dark of night, to Jesus. And Jesus receives him and answers his questions. Not in a way he was expecting, I'm sure. And in a way that probably left him wondering, what is he still wondering? What is this Jesus talking about? What does all this mean? What does he mean when he says we have to be born of water and the Spirit? What is that about? It's questions we still have today. What does our baptism mean to us? What does it mean to be washed with the water, to have water poured over us, or in some cases, to have our whole bodies dunked in a body of water, as some do? What does all of that mean for us? For Nicodemus, we don't know anything. He isn't mentioned in the Gospels again until the crucifixion of Jesus. We don't hear anything else about Nicodemus except he was one of the two persons. He and Joseph of Arimathea. He and Joseph took Jesus down from the cross, anointed him with many different perfumes and spices that had a way of driving away the smell of death. They wrapped him in a linen cloth and they carried him to a tomb that was in a garden near where Jesus was crucified. The interesting thing about that is that Joseph and Nicodemus, who were both members of the Sanhedrin, chose to do this on the day of preparation for the Passover. And the fact that they were willing to expose themselves and to take on taking Jesus' body down from the cross, Jesus' bloody body down from the cross, and touch his body, meant they desecrated themselves. They made themselves unclean, according to Jewish law. By Jewish law, you couldn't touch a dead body. You could not touch another person's blood, even your own blood, without becoming unclean to perform the rituals of the Sabbath or the rituals of Passover. But Joseph and Nicodemus choose to humiliate themselves, to shame themselves by doing this, by coming in contact with the dead Jesus, with the bloody Jesus. And Jewish law had a way that they could then clean themselves, but it would be a matter of several days that it would take to ritually clean themselves again, to be ready that they could participate fully in the rituals of the Sabbath or of Passover. So somewhere between this night, this dark night, where Nicodemus comes to Jesus with all these questions, and the last hours of the day of the crucifixion, when Joseph and Nicodemus take Jesus down from the cross and lay him in a tomb, Nicodemus continues to hear Jesus and becomes willing to humiliate himself, to shame himself in the light of his peers, his colleagues, his friends by doing this. So that Jesus may be laid in a tomb, in a grave where no one else has been laid. So without Nicodemus laying him in that tomb, that is where Jesus is, where the resurrection happens. Nicodemus, in a real way, prepares Jesus for the resurrection. Prepares the way for the resurrection, for the light of the resurrection to happen for all of us. So the question comes for us. How is it that we are willing to serve others? Maybe in a way that, you know, others don't understand. Maybe even in a way that some people would look upon as being humiliating, as being shaming, that you would actually do that, that you would actually associate with those people. Whoever those people, and I let you define who those people are for you and for your friends. What is that about for you? And whom are you called to serve? As Nicodemus served Jesus and served us. I'm not here to try and answer that question for you. It's a question you need to go within yourselves and answer for yourselves within this community. But it's also a question we as a community have to ask one another. What are ways that we are called to serve that the world may not understand, that it goes contrary to all that the world teaches, in order that the light of Christ may shine for all people, for all creation, in order that God's love may be made known to all creation, to all the world. This is a time, Lent is a time when we look within ourselves, when we look within our community to look at how is God calling us? What is God calling us to be? What is God calling us to do? And how are we going to do that? How is it that we are going to make the light of Christ shine for all creation? That is a question we face here at Morningstar and in the church throughout the world as we think of Lent. As we think of preparing ourselves for the risen Jesus in our lives, for the love that God has for all the world. Amen.
Invite the congregation to please stand as you're able as we continue with our next song.
I invite the children to come up again and play some shakers. Give us some water sounds. And we were baptized in water, remembering.
Please join me as we confess our faith together through the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Turning our hearts to God, who is gracious and merciful, we pray for the church, for the world, and all who are in need. Let us pray. God of creation, empower your church throughout the world to be a voice of hope for those who fear judgment or condemnation. Assure us of your faithfulness and give us confidence to proclaim your salvation for all. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of rebirth, your spirit hovered over the waters and you called creation into being. Nurture and bless all signs of rebirth and new growth, new life around us. Budding trees and new shoots, thawing lakes, warm breezes, animals who awake from hibernation. Remind us of the preciousness of your creation and how you call us to be stewards of it. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. God, you lead the nations in your way of righteousness. Protect those who advocate for the needs of children, for migrants, for victims of violence. Give courage to our lawmakers, to judges, to law enforcement officers. Guide them in ways of justice and to love mercy. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God, our healer, give us a new vision of your healing power among us. Restore hope to those who remain in the depths of depression or despair. Bring mercy and relief to those who are injured, sick, or suffering in body, mind, or spirit in any way. We lift up to you this morning Dolores and Ray, Rich and Ken, pray for Rick and Eunice, Gloria, Marge. We lift up Betty Wilson, Daryl. And Lord, we pray for those who are in the midst of grief. We lift up to you this day Sydney Winstrom upon the death of Bill. We pray for the Beck family and for loved ones of Zach who died this past week. And Lord, we lift up to you those loved ones who we hold in the silence of our own hearts. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. God, we give you thanks for the children in this congregation and for the people and ministries that care for them and to help them grow in their faith. We ask that you bless new and expectant parents and console those who have lost children or perhaps those who desire for children, whose desire for children remains unfulfilled. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of new life, by wind and spirit, you call us into life renewed. We give you thanks for all your saints who have inherited your promises. Bring us now with them into your everlasting kingdom. Hear us, O God.
Mercy is great.
According to your steadfast love, O God, hear these in all our prayers as we commend them now to you through Christ our Lord. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. I invite you to turn and share that peace now with one another. Our worship by sharing our gifts and our offerings. Thank you. As you're able. Holy and generous host, you set a table where we feast as friends. Prepare us to witness to your goodness with every gift you have given us to share, that all people may know your peace through Jesus Christ, both now and forever. Amen. Amen. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord's table has been prepared, and all are invited. Be seated, please.
Apart, I know you're drawing me to yourself.
Invite the congregation to stand as you're able. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen.
Amen.
Please join me as we pray. We thank you, living God, for the body and blood of your Son, which sustains us in the wilderness and the garden alike. As Christ has loved us in this feast, so send us to love Christ and our neighbors. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now is the acceptable time. Now is the day of salvation. Holy God, speaking, spoken, and inspiring, bless you, unbind you, and send you now forth in love and in peace. Amen.
Amen. And we would like to send you forth singing a new song, too. This is God So Loved, and the children can shake. Shake, shake, shake their shakers and let their spirit be known.
Whosoever believes will not perish.
shall have eternal life. Yes, they shall have eternal life.
Let's go forth now in peace and share the good news. Thanks be to God.
So long. Yeah.